a title I borrow from, Dr. Seuss, but also there was a workshop at the INT. Is it on or just too low? Okay. And the other thing I don't have is a clicker, which is my fault for not setting it up. So excuse me for having to walk in front of the screen every now and then. Okay. Well, I've been doing LHC physics for the last few years. So. And most of you are doing other things, and the technical details of what I'm up to are probably of no interest to you at all. So I thought I would give a talk, first of all, reviewing a little bit of the experience that I had working with Joe in the last decade, and then make a few comments about what's going on at the LHC that I think everyone ought to know, and then turn to some personal and hopefully extremely provocative remarks. After all, this should be an entertaining conference, so I hope I will entertain you. And there's some homework for Joe as well. All right, well, I first met Joe when I was a graduate student at Stanford. I took a trip down the coast. I just drove down, stopped in at Caltech, stopped in at Santa Barbara to meet people and see what people were doing. And I remember walking into Joe's office and chatting with him a little bit. I had some technical problem with my thesis. I couldn't figure out what function to use to transform this to that. And Joe said, oh, yeah, it's this one. And that was when I first got a little hint that you can ask Joe anything. He tends to know the answer. So we had many conversations over the years that were after that. While I was a postdoc, I came here several times to visit the KITP. And we always had interesting conversations. I think we always appreciated the types of questions that we were asking. But we never did talk about a project. And then, of course, there was the project that we worked on together, which is best known. And just to review, because I think history is interesting, how does it happen that someone like me ends up working with Joe, since we were coming from very different places? I just happened to have been very interested in the field theory of n equals 4 broker than n equals 1. I had read the work of Waffe and Witten, studied it very carefully, also the work of Donaghy and Witten. And let me just mention, because it'll come up, a couple of key facts about those papers. So Waffe and Witten had classified all of the classical vacua of this theory, and specifically noted that the vacua are classified by the n-dimensional potentially reducible representations of SU2. The three complex scalar fields of n equals 4 take values in those reducible representations. And that's the full set of classical vacua. And in particular, there's one vacuum where the gauge group is completely Higgs, where the scalar fields take values in the n-dimensional irreducible representation. And then, of course, there's a vacuum where the fields are just zero. That's classically unbroken. And that vacuum quantum mechanically splits to give you, they studied the case of SU2. It splits to give you a monopole vacuum and a Dyon vacuum. And in this case, we also have the Higgs vacuum. These three vacua are rotated into each other by SL2Z. And that was generalized in Donaghy and Witten, where they looked at n equals 4 broken to n equals 2, and then broken very slightly further to n equals 1, and showed very beautifully that if you looked at the vacua that had mass gaps, so no U1s left over, then all of the phases of gauge theory that were possible under Itoff's classification appeared exactly once, and they were all rotated into each other by SL2Z. So I knew something about that, and I also knew something about the fuzzy sphere because I was Institute for Advanced Study postdoc, and Dan Kabat, who was a friend and collaborator at earlier times, was also there, and he had done some work with Waddy Taylor looking at fuzzy spheres, that is, say, a D2 brain in the shape of a sphere with D0 brain charge. And in particular, the D2 brain sphere is represented by having three scalar fields in the n-dimensional irreducible representation of SU2. So I knew those two things, and then I was very lucky to come to the KITP in 1999. Thank you, KITP, because it certainly made a huge impact on my career. And I went to a talk given by Rob Myers, in which he described what we now call the Myers effect. And to remind those of you who are too young to have lived through this, the Myers effect is just a polarization effect. If you take an atom and you turn on an electric field, the charge gets polarized. And if instead you take n D0 brains and you turn on a four-form electric flux, The effect of that is that the brains puff up into a fuzzy two-sphere. And if you look at, so that's what's happening as far as the space-time view of this, but if you look at what's going on in the D0 brain world volume, this is happening through some change in the scalar potential. So my big idea was take everything that Rob is saying and add 3. Okay. Let's take a 7-form flux. We'll take D3 brains, and they'll puff up into a 5-sphere. And as long as you can make this supersymmetric, this is going to be n equals 4 breaking to n equals 1. And so this particular vacuum would be the Higgs vacuum, where the gauge group is completely broken. But now you just add S-duality to that. And so, of course, there will be a vacuum in which classically the gauge group is unbroken. All the D3 brains are coincident. But just by S-duality, you can see that you're going to be able to transform this one into an NS5 brain in the shape of an S2 cross R3. And that will be a monopole condensation and confinement and so forth. And so, you know, I could draw all these pictures pretty quickly and see that all the other vacua of Waff and Witten would be there and so forth and so on. And that's probably where it would have gone. I would probably have written a little paper with some pictures and some words and some, you know, arguments. But fortunately, I was here. And I talked to Joe. And after a couple of conversations, he got interested. And so at that point, the technical capacity of the people involved in this project increased by about a factor of 10. No, 100, probably more like. And what's fabulous about this project, from the point of view of having Joe on it, is that this is an incredibly rich quantum field theory. It has all sorts of different vacua with all sorts of different phenomena. If you ever just want to have some recreational activity just to, you know, let your brain think about something else, just go take a look at all the different things that happen in this theory. Everything you can think of in field theory shows up there somewhere, and it all gets represented in terms of strings and brains and brain intersections and bound states of brains and brains that are curved and brains that have to join. And I don't think anybody could have calculated all of these things other than Joe, because he knew all of it. All of the Chern-Simons terms mattered. All of the structure of the field equations mattered. Everything mattered. And there's no way I could have done any of that stuff. Especially for those of you who like these sorts of calculations, recreationally, read this paper carefully. There are so many calculations in there. And I assure you, all the ones that involve brains, I was just learning, and Joe was doing all of them. And what was fantastic about this is they were rigorous. Joe had to invent all sorts of methods to figure out for each problem what was the right perturbation series to do. And it was never trivial. The calculation was always tricky. And in the end, there was an answer that you could compare with the quantum field theory. So just as a particularly wonderful example, it may be not by no means the most difficult, but certainly one of the most wonderful in the project, was the first thing we had to do was compute what happens if you put a probe in. Now you just take ADS space. You don't worry about any back reaction. But you put a probe D5 brain with some three brains on it. And the right way to do that calculation, as Joe quickly understood, is you put the three brains in first, then you treat the five brain as a small correction. That makes it a lot easier. And so he did that calculation all the way through. And it was not an easy calculation, but we got the final answer. And then Joe sat down, and at that point I was wondering, how in the world are we ever going to, I mean, this was not easy, how in the world are we ever going to get something with the back reaction in there? And then one day I got an email from Joe, or maybe it was a phone call, I don't even remember, and he told me, well, it turns out it's the same calculation. We're done. And first of all, this was amazing, but second of all, if that probe calculation hadn't been done all the way through to the end, with every detail correct, then this wouldn't have been true. So it was critical to get all those details right. So it was amazing to watch Joe at work. And the other wonderful thing about this is that you can really see, I mean, people knew this already, but you can really see in this context that D-brains are not just about string theory. They are all over quantum field theory in a very real sense. One way in which that shows up in this context is the following. So here what I've drawn is I've drawn a D5 brain. Here's the S2. These are the internal directions. Here's one of the spatial directions in ordinary space. And, of course, a magnetic monopole is a D1 brain that hangs down from the boundary down into the vacuum. And here's an anti-monopole. And they would be connected by a magnetic flux tube in the Higgs vacuum. And that flux tube is nothing other than a D1, D5 brain bound state. And by S-duality, the confining vacuum that we're really interested in QCD-like theories is a bound state of an F1, of an ordinary string to an NS5 brain. So the flux tubes that you can calculate in Higgs vacua, those are really, from this point of view, d-brains. But even more so is the fact that baryons are d-brains. What's a baryon in this context? Well, here's our confining vacuum in an NS5 brain. It's a D3 brain that is a ball. It fills the S2. Where does this come from? Well, Witten showed that a baryon vertex in the ordinary N=4 Young-Mills is a D5 brain that wraps the 5 sphere. Here, that if you pull that 5 brain through the NS brain, you get a brain crossing phenomenon and the creation of a D3 brain via the Hanani-Witten effect. And so the D5 brain crosses the NS5 brain, and what you end up with is a D3 brain. And so this theory has vacua in which you have both NS5 brains and D5 brains, where the gauge group is partially broken. So you have W bosons that are in the fundamental representation of the confining gauge group. And so you really can build these baryons. They're really there. They're not just vertices. They're really physical objects. And you could study, if you wanted to, you could study how they behaved. You could probably make nuclei out of them. Nobody ever tried, but they would probably exist. There are also domain walls between, let's say, the confining vacuum and an oblique confining vacuum. And those are D5 brains, which, again, fill a ball inside the S2 and then have two additional directions left over, which form a wall. And so I think it's really important to think of baryons in this context as D-brains. They are effective. The baryons are effective D0 brains, and domain walls are effective D2 brains in the field theory. So there is a real sense that one of Joe's major contributions to the field is that it gave us a new perspective on something very important, which is that baryons are D-brains, right? Flux tubes are strings. Baryons are D-brains. And it's hard for us to remember this sometimes because we're in a regime where this is not obvious. But obviously, if quarks were heavier, and so flux tubes did not break instantly, and if we were at a little bit larger end, this would be obvious physically. But it's still true conceptually. Our collaboration continued for several more years. We wrote 3 more papers. I think anyone who's worked with Joe probably has had this experience. So in this project, where we looked at how scattering of hadrons works in gauge theory, and where we were able to show that even at strong coupling, scattering of hadrons at fixed angles scales like power laws. And this is true at weak coupling, but remarkably, it's also true at strong coupling. And the ultraviolet softness of string theory plays a big role in that. Joe solved this problem during a conversation in which we were talking about things, and I think I was talking about one thing, and he was talking about something else, and he solved that problem while we were talking. And so he had solved the problem, and I didn't even know what the problem was. After a couple of days, I got into it. Well, you know, sometimes with Joe, that's the other thing, is he solves the problem, he knows the answer, and you try to get it to explain it to you, and he can't, at least not right away. So it was a couple of days before I even knew what we were working on. But we wrote a paper anyway. The other nice thing about this paper is that we were able to see in this context why it is that you would get power laws at fixed angles. But when you went to small angles into the Reggie region, the physics would effectively become a 4-dimensional string theory. And therefore, all the things that people have done in the Reggie region in the distant past, in some sense, was justified in this context, at least in the idea of safety context. This was a very exciting paper for us because I think it really said to us that maybe there are things about strong coupling which we can use to really learn about QCD directly. And the next paper was kind of a downer because what we discovered was that hadrons are very different. There are no hard partons in a hadron at strong coupling. And this is essentially coming from the statement that when you're at large coupling, there are large violations of Bjorkane scaling. The easiest way to say that is that the reason Bjorkane scaling works, even in QCD, is that the twist 2 operators, or the classically twist 2 operators that have spin greater than 2, have small anomalous dimensions. But as Juan showed us, that in this regime, any operator whose spin is higher than 2 is a string, and therefore has large anomalous dimensions, and therefore Bjorkane scaling is badly violated. And the physics of this is that if you produce a hard, high-energy quark or gluon, it's going to radiate like crazy. And so instead of, as at weak coupling, you produce something, and it radiates maybe a couple of gluons, and it keeps most of its energy. Here, if you produce anything with substantial energy, it just radiates it off into a large number of very soft particles. And that means that all of the partons end up in the Regi region at small x. Now, I do want to emphasize, that already at this point, you can conclude that there aren't going to be any jets at strong coupling. I couldn't prove it for years. And so in the end, I just threw it into a paper, and Juan proved it with Hoffman around the same time and independently. And there was also a paper by Janku, Hattu, and Miller. But it really follows from this, because if you look, although you can't make the operator statements as cleanly in the jet context as you can in deep and elastic scattering, if you look at the calculations and you look at the physical intuition, it's the same. At weak coupling, the calculations are literally almost identical. We were finally able to get into the Regi region as deeply as we wanted, working with Rich Brower and Chung Yi Tan, who are both here, on a paper in which we were able to take all the different things that were known about the Pomeron and QCD, some of which go by the name of BFKL, there's the soft Regi region, and so forth, and we were able to unify them together in a single picture that shows that the Pomeron really is a unified concept in the context of field theory, something which was not known, although it had been conjectured by Levin and Tan, that there was some unification to be done. And I think one of the really nice things that's not appreciated in this paper is that Joe introduced the notion of a Pomeron vertex operator, which, as far as we know, had never been introduced before, showed it made sense, did all sorts of fantastic calculations, and allowed us to resolve explicitly some longstanding quantum field theory issues. So in relation to what Andreas was saying, I think this is another place where we actually did make a contribution to field theory and our understanding of field theory in general. Okay, so thank you, Joe. This is really great. This is one of the great experiences of my career to have this collaboration. All right, let me spend a few minutes, just a few, on what's going on at LHC, and then I'll pull your chain for a little bit. Okay, so you most of you know the LHC ran in 2011, 2012. Most of you probably don't realize that there were 500,000 Higgs bosons produced per experiment. That's a lot. We're going to get more starting in 2015. Nobody knows exactly what the energy is going to be. Just the increase in the energy will increase the number of Higgses by 2 or 3. And of course, the collision rate will go up a little bit, not that much, but it will go up gradually. I do think it's important to emphasize that, you know, there's been lots of analysis on this data, but there's no sense in which the analysis is complete. And I'll say a little bit about it. Because this is, of course, one of the issues that disturbs me. Are we really, we have all this data, but are we getting all the information out of it that we should be getting? This is really critical. Well, they found the Higgs. That's great. Obviously, the question now is it a standard model Higgs or not? And there are sort of four classes of questions that you'd want to know the answer to. First is you measure everything that the Higgs does and is supposed to do, and you measure it very precisely. All the standard model production modes, all the standard model decay modes. But then, and the experimenters are great at this, and they're doing it very well, and they've got lots of personnel measuring everything to the last decimal place that they can possibly reach. And this is great. And then, of course, the Higgs might be produced in some funny way. Maybe the top quark decays to a charm quark plus a Higgs sometime. Or maybe there's a heavy version of the top quark, and it produces these things sometimes. Or perhaps there's a heavy Higgs that decays to the lighter Higgses. And they've got some work going on in that direction. There's some papers coming out. Maybe there's more work going on than I know about. Then, of course, the Higgs might not decay the way we expect. There might be some additional particles we don't know about to which it can decay, which then, in turn, would give us a signal. And there has been almost no work on that at all on the experimental side. And, of course, there could be other Higgs bosons or scalars. I don't know if you want to call them Higgses, but other parts to the Higgs sector that we should be looking for, maybe decaying in ways that are easy to find, maybe in ways that are not so easy. So one of the things I've been doing is pushing the experimenters to do more of this and along the way to do more of that, the last two categories. And so with the 12 young people, and this was really on their initiative, not just mine, we organized to both review what's in the literature and also calculate a few more things and suggest more studies and even extract from existing data some actual limits on the possibility of non-standard decays. And we didn't cover everything because there's so many possibilities, but we covered a lot. And we hope that since none of these things have been done, but we gave really good arguments as to why they should be done, that the experimenters will start doing them. But it's important to realize that discoveries could still be sitting in the 2011-2012 data, and we would not know about them at this point. Conversely, in addition to looking at the Higgs and trying to see whether it's standard or not, there is, of course, looking for everything else that might be there. Is there anything beyond the standard model? Well, we haven't had a discovery. But there's a long way from discovery to exclusion. And one place you do not want to end up is in the middle, where you don't know where you are. You want to exclude supersymmetry. You have a lot of work to do. Obviously, that's very difficult. So we need comprehensive coverage. We need to know that we have the comprehensive coverage. We need to have thought carefully about whether we've covered all the bases. And so some work with Jared Evans, Evgeny Katz, and David Shi was aimed at this, to try to understand, had the experimenters done everything that needs to be done, so that with the minimal set of assumptions that you can possibly make, you can say supersymmetry, at least in some region of parameter space, is gone without holes. So the trick that we used was the following. We considered what I would say is natural supersymmetry, where the Higgs-Eno is not somehow taken far away from the Higgs in mass. So, you know, you can put your favorite number here. I'm not saying you should take this number seriously, but the strategy we're using is what you should take seriously. So we chose 400 GeV as our naturalness bound. You could choose 500. You would get similar answers. And then we looked at the Gluino, because the Gluino has to be there. You can't move it around too much. It's connected with naturalness in some way. And also, it's hard to hide. It's got a big cross-section. And no matter how it decays, in the end, you're either going to get invisible particles, which will give you large missing energy, or MET. You will get top quarks most of the time, because after all, Gluino top stop is part of, it's a coupling that's there in supersymmetry. So unless you forbid it by kinematics, that decay is going to be there. And if you somehow manage to get rid of both of these things, you get rid of them by having the Gluino decay to a bunch of other things, which means you get high multiplicity. Now, you might get lots of leptons. That would be easy to find, so we can forget about that. So then you're looking for a final state which has a lot of jets in it. And the point, as of 2011, when we started thinking about this project, is that the experimenters really had covered this territory, which is sort of standard, a few jets plus a large amount of missing energy. And they'd covered this corner to some degree using the black hole search, which, of course, wasn't intended for supersymmetry at all, but it does the job. While we were writing the project, a lot more results came out from the experimenters. And by the time we put the paper out in October, I think I can say with confidence that they'd added in searches for small amounts of MET with a large number of jets, and they'd expanded these searches, and they really did cover the territory. So more explicitly, up to 950 GeV, and typically higher, in almost any scenario you can think of, no matter what you put in for the supersymmetric spectrum, you change the spectrum, you add additional particles, you let the Gluino decay with R-parity violation, they got it. They covered it. I can tell you that for supersymmetry. I can't tell you that for some of the other theories that are out there. We do need this sort of complete coverage so that we can say whether or not the standard model is, in fact, describing what's in the data, or we just missed something. So anyway, that's what I've been up to. I didn't think you'd want to hear the details. But now, I think it's important to ask the question, well, what if, indeed, 5 years from now, for Joe's 65th birthday, or his 70th, we are having a conference, and as far as we can tell, we've done complete coverage. They've looked for all those Higgs decays. We've looked for supersymmetry in all the right places, looked for all the different models. And as far as anyone can tell, all we have is a standard model. Now what? So,
yeah. You say the data, you mean the data that's kept on tape, right?
The data that they throw away is the data that is gone. It might as well never exist. So I only mean things that they...
Cots are already put in place.
Triggers. Triggers. The data you have is the data you didn't throw away. Now, what you do with it, how you analyze it, that's another matter. And that's my job, to make sure they analyze it well. All right, supposing the LHC finds nothing except the Higgs. Well, you know, we could be dealing with the possibility that the naturalist problem is not quite solved. There's a little bit of tuning. You throw in an epicycle. You say, well, OK, it's not at 1 TeV the way we expected. Maybe it's at 10. I don't really feel comfortable with this. I mean, once you open the door and you say, well, it's not at 1, it's maybe higher, the standard model has been screaming at us for years that there's nothing up to 100 TeV.
That is
That is mini-split. Fair enough. We'll come back to that in a second. Because that's not really my point today. The severe naturalness starts to kick in at that point. Another possibility is anthropic reasoning or a combination of the two. And what I really want to talk about is the anthropic issue. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just mean there's no flavor check neutral currents. So that just means that, you know, probably the new physics is at least 100 TeV. It's probably more than that. All we know is that the standard model is perfectly happy, given with no extra operators, up to 100 TeV or more. So just tuning things a little bit, I mean, why are you bothering? You should push it up at least to 100. Let's put this in the discussion, because that's really not my focus. Okay. All right. As I said, I'm going to be controversial. We're going to have more to discuss. Okay, so about the anthropics. Okay, so the anthropic arguments, I think, should be thought of in the following way. And you have a space of theories or vacua. We don't know what it is. But within that context, I'm perfectly happy with the notion that, yes, you should focus on the vacua which have a small cosmological constant. You do need structure. And you need the universe to be long enough lived for that. And I'm perfectly happy with the statement that you need a hierarchy. There should be a hierarchy between gravity and other things. Otherwise, every object you make will just collapse into a black hole, and you're not going to have planets or stars or even humans that can. You need some sort of environment which is stable, long-lived, and has the possibility of objects that are non-gravitational. So, small cosmological constant, large hierarchy. This logically has nothing whatsoever to do with the question of why we have a light scalar. That's a third independent point. So while after you've imposed these two points, you're limited to some set of vacua within the space of vacua that you started in. But why would you think that the space of vacua has a significant number of vacua that have a light scalar? You haven't addressed the hierarchy problem. Sorry, you have not addressed the naturalness problem at all. All right, so this is what I want to focus attention on. Why should the vacua that have a small cosmological constant, a large hierarchy, also have a light scalar? And I don't know. Now, Nima and Savas gave us a context, gave us an example of which it would be, in which this would be true. If, for example, the particle content of the standard model was fixed, the forces were fixed, the dimensionless couplings were roughly fixed, and the dimension-full couplings could scan because of coupling the system to an additional system that had a large number of vacua, then indeed the only way that you could get a world that has those properties would be to have the light Higgs. Because the light Higgs and the small VeV would go together, and the small VeV is necessary in order to have a hierarchy at all, and you need that hierarchy. But why should you be limited to this subspace? I mean, if instead of this particular subspace of quantum field theory, your space of theories was all of quantum field theory, you certainly wouldn't come to that conclusion. Because after dealing with the cosmological constant, the requirement of a hierarchy, you would have several different options. Supersymmetry and technicolor, you all know. The other one worth pointing out is micro-Yukawas, as I don't know what the best term is for this. But this is basically the idea that you have some long-range forces. VeVs for fields, VeVs for any scalar fields are very large. And the Yukawa couplings that give you the small masses for the electron and so forth, they just come through higher dimension operators. Right? So they're effective Yukawa couplings. And, you know, what's wrong with those things? Take a field theory coupled to gravity. Any one of those seems perfectly reasonable. And so it's hard to imagine a subspace or a criterion that gets rid of all three of these at the same time. At least I don't know of one at the moment. And, of course, the reason why this is so important for a lot of people in this audience is, you know, in string theory, do we really think that we're limited to a subspace which is just the standard model or even something like that? I mean, what in string theory would suggest this is the situation? Everything we know about string theory suggests that, you know, all three of these possibilities are there. And any criterion I've heard that, well, maybe string theory doesn't like supersymmetry or string theory doesn't like large gauge groups or something, I don't know of any argument that rules out all three of these. And so string theory, even with anthropic reasoning, has a serious naturalness problem, I would claim. In fact, I'll even go out on a limb. You could make the claim. You can make the claim. I'm not gonna make this claim, but I think you see where I'm going. Okay, you could make an argument that only finding the standard model of the LHC is an argument against string theory. And so my homework for Joe, can you at least give us some evidence that this claim is not true? That is there something that can be shown in string theory such that that a person who made this claim could be argued, you could argue against them? At this point, I don't think you could.
This is string theory as we
currently. And you notice that, right. And I think that's an important point. And so I agree with you that pushing more deeply into string theory and maybe pushing outside of string theory are both important directions to go. But one should, and of course, we don't even know that we're dealing with a standard model only at the LHC. The LHC is not done yet. But we have to at least start thinking about this might be where we're headed. Now, related to this, and this will be my last point, is where we're going with the field. And so this is where Nima and I will have a lively debate, which is that the next step is a 100 TV machine. And, you know, of course, it would be great if the Chinese and the Europeans and maybe some future US government will allow us to build this machine, build a big tunnel where we can put in a very powerful E plus E minus collider and eventually a 100 TV proton-proton machine. But I'm a little worried about putting all the eggs in that basket. And it has to do with history. Of course, every lesson you learn from history is wrong, but you should still learn it. And that has to do with the following analogy. Let's go back to 1870s. Light is a wave. They knew a lot about waves. They knew a real lot about waves. And everybody knew from all sorts of theoretical and experimental evidence that waves come with a medium, and therefore you can measure whether you're at rest with respect to it or not. And so Michelson was clever enough to figure out that he could actually measure it and failed. And so you throw in an epicycle. You say, well, there's ether drag. And so we just need a more powerful interferometer. So he built one, and he didn't find it. And so there were more epicycles. Maybe it's a really subtle effect. You need even more powerful interferometers. Then people start thinking a little more cleverly, and Fitzgerald and Lorentz start thinking about, well, maybe matter is shifting and changing in some way as it moves to the ether. It's a wrong idea, but it's clever. Maybe you should be looking at internal strain in the material or something like that. Well, of course, in the end, the important experiment, if you'd wanted to get at this experimentally, would have been to measure the kinematics of objects traveling near the speed of light. Oh, and by the way, maybe you should look at stars during eclipse. And Mercury's perihelion, this is related to this too. Now, I suspect if you'd walk into Michelson's office and told him those three things, he might have been smart enough to actually realize you were talking sense. But a lot of people would have said you're nuts. So what's the lesson we should draw from this? I mean, it seems to me that a failure of Wilsonian intuition, for which we have tremendous theoretical evidence, and for which we have experimental evidence in the context of condensed matter physics, and we have QCD, is comparable in shock value to that observation from the 1880s. It's non-appearance of something we really deeply expected on highly educated grounds. And so maybe it's just a little more tuning. We just need a machine that's a little more, got a little more energy, maybe a factor of 10 more. Although for the fact that we might need to go to 100 TV makes me worry that even 10 times wouldn't be nearly enough. But I worry that we're just missing the point. And we're planning entirely the wrong experiments. And the crucial hint may not be coming from any of the experiments we're doing because we're just not doing the right kind. And so maybe a theorist really who is thinking about the problem in a different way, suggesting a different class of experiments that we really need. And I especially direct this at the young people whose minds are open enough to maybe think of something that's way off the target that we have. So I'd like to argue, and I'm concluding here, there's some sense in which the standard model only at the LHC is circumstantial evidence against effective quantum field theory. And I probably should have said effective quantum field theory coupled to classical, semi-classical gravity in flat space as a complete description of what's going on in particle physics. And it raises questions as to whether high energy is the correct direction to go. And so more homework for Joe. Are there crucial experiments that we're not only doing them, we're not even thinking about considering them? And Joe, because of what I mentioned earlier, explain your wisdom. Okay, so congratulations, Joe. It's been wonderful to watch your career. You've had an amazing career. It's been fun to be around while you've been having it. It's clearly not over. The amps things show you're as fresh as ever. And so personally, thank you. It's been fabulous. It's been an incredible privilege to work with you. But don't forget your homework. Thank you.
I'm sure there are many responses to that provocation, but I'd like to make a remark. Effective field theory was invented to discuss infrared physics, knowing that you have control over what happens at microscopic distances, and is most powerful in that respect. Going towards the ultraviolet is going towards the unknown in general. In terms of effective field theory, you have an infinite number of relevant operators, irrelevant operators. And the best guide to go to the ultraviolet or to, you know, is experiment. It has always been. So it is not, you know, a crazy thing to go and explore to try to go another order of magnitude down. That's just humility, modesty.
I'm not suggesting it's crazy. I'm not suggesting it's crazy. I'm suggesting
That's what you suggested.
No. I didn't say that. I said...
You suggested that going to explore another range of energies, another range of distances, is similar to the arrogance of theoretical physicists back at the end of the century.
You're putting words in my mouth, David. It was not crazy for Michelson to build a better interferometer. It just wasn't the full set of possibilities for things that he could do.
He was testing a hypothesis. In fact,
and a smart hypothesis.
And
it was a smart hypothesis. And yes. It was a smart thing. I'm not saying the 100 GeV collider is a bad idea. I'm saying it may not be a good idea to only focus on that. That really, in Michelson's case, building a better interferometer was important. But there were other experiments to be done that no one was thinking about.
Such as?
Like Kaufman's experiment for the particle mass and inertia changes.
Yeah.
Well, that was many years later.
It was.
And in
and I'm trying to hope...
In response to Einstein, of course.
That's right.
Yes. Fine. So, this would have been better... I mean, it really is, I think, a little dangerous for theorists based on the failure of what I regard as not a principle of... or even a hypothesis about the laws of nature, but rather a strategy. The failure of a strategy called naturalness, right, to therefore suggest that we shouldn't go on and go the next stage of exploration of energies and distances. No, you were suggesting
I was very clear, David. I was very clear.
Whether high energy physics is the right experimental direction without suggesting an alternative.
I didn't suggest an alternative for the same reason that people in the 1880s didn't suggest an alternative. They hadn't thought about it enough yet.
Very few people in the 1880s even noticed what Michelson was doing.
That's right.
Right.
That's right.
Anyway, we can, that's...
I'd like to rephrase this thing before we continue. Imagine we didn't know any quantum field theory. And there were just more and more accelerators going with higher and higher energies. We didn't know any field theory, certainly not effective field theory. What would be the question? Well, we just keep marching. I think what you're saying here is not that this would be evidence against quantum field theory. What you're advocating is an evidence against reductionism. And I think many people will object to that. The idea was that we don't want to understand better. We just have to go to shorter and shorter distances. And that has been a trend for centuries. And it would be ridiculous if this trend is wrong now. Why would it be wrong?
Except that quantum gravity already has shown us examples.
Still have a long way to go till we go to quantum gravity.
So I would assume that's true.
But at 1 TeV or 10 TeV or 100 TeV or maybe 1,000 TeV, reductionism is probably still true. Okay. And this has nothing to do with quantum field, effective quantum field theory.
I agree with
since
that.
Since I have the microphone, I want to say one more thing.
Okay. I have a microphone too, Nadia, and I know how to use it. Go ahead.
Go ahead. I just had two comments. First, the question of why you should have a light scalar was one that Savas and I thought about when we were thinking about Split-Suzy. Also, Raman Sundram and David E. Kaplan did a similar exercise as this exercise I'm about to mention. Why have a light Higgs instead of Technicolor to break electroweak symmetry? And the answer is kind of interesting. If you actually try to build a concrete Technicolor model, which also gives you just the first generation masses, which is clearly also anthropically important. An issue arises that actually I think Lenny mentioned, maybe Lenny and Savas mentioned it in their first ETC paper, that in order to actually get the fermion masses not tremendously small, get them all with an interesting range of each other, you actually have to have some tuning to get all the QCD scales to line up to be not exponentially far apart from each other. And it's very easy to get in much larger hierarchies than what we actually get. So the conclusion of the exercise I did and that David Ian Raman did is that even the simplest possible Technicolor model with just the first generation, no scalars, was already tuned at worse than a part in a million level. So it's actually, if we're talking about tunings in this modest regime, it's easier to have supersymmetry and then some tuning for a scalar than to just than to try to do it all without scalars. There's another physics point, which is that you could have also asked, why have anything break electroweak symmetry at all instead of just letting the weak interactions do it? The weak interactions could easily do it. I meant the strong interactions. The strong interactions could easily do it with higher dimension operators generating fermion masses. There's also a reasonable anthropic reason, which is that in a world where electroweak symmetry is broken by the strong interactions, there's no baryons. The sphalerons completely convert all baryons into neutrinos, and that's
tremendously. We know without deep brains would be a terrible thing.
And just a final comment about going to 100 TeV. I don't think anyone is suggesting that we put all our eggs in that basket. That's obviously ridiculous. We obviously need to be thinking about many, many kinds of experiments. But there is a completely clear case to be made for both studying the heck out of the Higgs. We've never seen a particle like it ever before. We've never seen an elementary spin zero particle before. The naturalness issue is one of the strange things about it. Making an E plus E minus Higgs factory to study the heck out of, make millions of Higgses, study them accurately, that's a completely obvious thing to do, an analytic Absolutely. Continuation of the discovery. And B, we go to the energy frontier to as high energy as we can for the reason David said, because we go. And one of the things it would shed light on is the naturalness question. There would be lots of other things we might learn as well. So I think part of the reason for some intense focus on that now is that we need, for these really big projects, we need 20, 25 years to think, conceive, and plan them, and to motivate them. But I couldn't agree more that, many of us have spent a lot of time thinking about all kinds of other experiments we might be doing to probe fundamental physics on many scales. So and the fact that theorists should be thinking about that, I wholeheartedly agree with you.
I think one thing I'd like to add, I chose not to put this in the talk for lack of time, but it relates to Nadi's question. The standard model forms a complete package in a way that previously we have not had one. And so in the last, really, you can go back to the discovery of the electron, we have always had clear questions to ask which drove us in a reductionist direction, because we knew we didn't have the complete story. Now, the problem is, once you get the standard model as a complete story, it's no longer obvious it's still obvious that short distances are interesting, but it's not clear that you're going to get the insights that you need soon, and it's not clear that reductionism gives you the insight into why, that is, soon meaning as you go upward in energy, and it's also not clear that reductionism has to do with why you're solving the naturalist problem. To have an unnatural theory, it's not clear that going higher in energy is going to give you the answer.
Again, I would like to stress that the naturalness problem is not the failure of a law of physics or a hypothesis or a prediction. It's a strategy.
I don't think that's...
What does it violate? It simply violates your ability to calculate. Now, you can blame that on anthropic arguments, or you can blame that on the limitations of theory, but nobody said you should be able to calculate everything. It simply is, or it's picked out by anthropic arguments.
Well,
there's nothing it's very different than a prediction.
Yes.
Or a law of nature,
that's
or
correct.
Conservation law, or a symmetry principle that you can test qualitatively or quantitatively.
Look, it's always possible to say that naturalness is not a problem. You can always make the argument that the apparent unnaturalness of the standard model is just not a problem.
I regard the lack of our ability to calculate precisely or even imprecisely a problem, because I believe in the ultimate power of physics to calculate everything. Okay, so naturalness is simply a statement that there are parameters in the theory that you can't calculate. there's nothing wrong with a standard model given the ability to adjust something to 19 orders of digits, right? Why is that violating a principle of nature?
I didn't say it was violating a principle of nature. I said it's circumstantial evidence at best. Experiment is not going to deliver to us, unless we make an actual discovery of something. It's not going to deliver us an airtight argument. The question is, what should we actually be doing with our time? And one of my concerns is I think we have a rather narrow view of what we should be doing with our time. So part of the purpose of this talk is not that I'm giving you airtight arguments about anything, but that I want to give you arguments against thinking too narrowly about what the possibilities are. That's really all I'm trying to do here.
Okay. There is a choice. I think this might be part and parcel of Steve's session later on, planning for the for Joe's 90th birthday. We could easily get into a debate about the future of physics or high energy physics. There are a lot of people raising their hands. Joe should definitely get the last. But we're actually, if we were to stop now, on time. So I'll take, since this is so many people want to talk, let a few talk, and Joe will have the final word. So who desperately wants to say something? Stuart, Steve, and then Joe has the final word.
So I just want to make one comment about this. If there's no Susie found or anything found between one TeV, that you have to go up to 100 TeV. The frustrating fact is that, you're right, gluinos have been ruled out below TeV approximately. But when LHC turns on in 2015 and they get 300 inverse femtobonds of data, they can only discover gluinos up to 2 TeV. So they're not going to actually cover very much region. And so we're going to need a much higher energy machine in order to, because I don't believe that you, by saying that you don't see anything at 300 inverse femtobonds, that you've ruled out the region between 1 TeV and 100 TeV, that there could be a lot there which is consistent with flavor violation, and we just haven't seen it yet. So it's a problem.
We're not going to be able to rule that out. Definitely not. We're going to have to cope with it.
Just a brief comment. You know, we certainly have a scenario where the reductionist paradigm comes to an end, which is, well, it was imagined to be TeV scale gravity. Maybe it's a much higher scale, but that's when reductionism would end. But to find that, we have to go to higher energy, clearly.
So if you want an example of something that would be different, it might be that what we're looking for, I mean, again, if I had a scenario of this sort, I would give it to you. But in terms of just possibilities, if the scenario is somehow to produce something that's extremely weakly coupled to us and is light, then going to high energy doesn't necessarily help you. What you need is extremely high luminosity, or you need some clever, very subtle measurement. And then going to high energy doesn't buy you anything. So in other words, it really depends. You know, we have
Your
to be
argument
clever enough to
would be, Matt, you've never mentioned the word dark matter.
I haven't.
And your argument would be much stronger were it not for dark matter. Dark matter is independently of everything else a direct observation of something which...
Actually, I think it makes my argument much stronger. Because it tells you that there are things that you cannot necessarily discover by going to high energy, right? A lot of the dark matter models right now are about stellar neutrinos that are, you know, 5 keV. You don't need a 100 TeV collider to make them. You need huge luminosity. It's a totally different direction.
The final word goes to Joe.
Now, I actually wanted to return to the first and least controversial part of your talk, just because you gave your impression of that collaboration. I wanted to give mine. So being at the KITP is great because I sit here and all these great young people come through, and sometimes we write papers together. But one of the most remarkable experiences was having Matt come into my office and basically give me the entire solution to this important unsolved problem of the dual to a confining gauge theory. He basically had 100% of the field theory side and 80% of the string theory side. And would I help him fill in the last 20%? That's not how you saw it. That's how I saw it.
Very kind of you to say it that way, Joe. But
I'm glad on some of our later papers I contributed more. But it's challenging working with Matt. This paper has never been submitted for publication because it never met his standard.
That's not really true.
But I should mention that Stanley Mandelstam is here, and my thesis problem for understanding Mandelstam was essentially to use duality to prove confinement in QCD. And I didn't succeed. Somehow I graduated anyway. But thanks to Matt, 15 years later, I finally solved my thesis problem. So.
Thanks, Joe.
Okay. So we're going to break for lunch. And please make sure to wear your tag so you won't be thrown out. And we're coming back at 2 p.m. when Nemo will tell us what quantum field theory is.